Nick Mosby, I'm sitting here with HipHopSince1987.com.
HipHopSince1987.com.
What's going on, Hip Hop Since 1987 fans? It is your boy Eric Hennigan with the running mayor for Baltimore
City, yeah.
Nick Mosby. How are you, man?
I'm doing well.
It's my pleasure to be sitting here with you. Thank you for having us out. Now, first and foremost, I have to ask, what initially got you into politics?
So growing up, you know, I tell people my story all the time. I grew up in Northeast Baltimore to a 3-bedroom house with 6 women. Shared a bedroom with my mother and my older sister to the 8th grade. And you know, my mother was just always real active in our community. She always, you know, was very on the front lines for ensuring that, you know, our community had, you know, different opportunities and different initiatives were coming through our community. So, you know, I was there from the beginning. She took me every time to vote with her, you know, let me pull the lever back in the day in the old machines. And you know, she just was really socially conscious and really active in our community. So I think that's where it just got the fire.
And sparked it for you.
Yep.
Okay. Now, Baltimore was definitely the focus of the nation's attention after, I'll say, the youth spoke out for the world to see. Let me ask you, what are some of the policies that you want to introduce that will help fix Baltimore, for lack of a better word?
So in Baltimore on the council, I've passed the most progressive ban the box law, which is basically fair hiring law. So you know, all folks who, you know, have had past criminal transgressions and been incarcerated, even with felonies, no longer in Baltimore City do you have to check the box on an application, nor can an employer ask you that question during the application or the interviewing process. So a conditional offer has to be rendered before somebody can figure out what your pass is, and at that point they can make a decision. It's really similar to like a P test for a drug test. So that's one thing I've done on the council, but what I will do as the next mayor of Baltimore is really just go after, you know, our school to prison pipeline. You know, right now we see, you know, the school system in the city of Baltimore is not providing our young folks with the foundation to be amazing citizens. They're not providing them with the foundation to really grow a sustainable economy and communities in our areas. And, you know, that's one thing I'm going to go after. Another thing in Baltimore City, it's a major problem, is lead paint poisoning. You know, hundreds of children are impacted by lead paint on a yearly basis, and we need to, administration is going to aggressively go after it. And then lastly, reentry policy. You know, we're going to develop a one-stop shop to, when folks come home, they'll be able to go to this location, get identification cards, understand and know where they are from a child support perspective, have all the wraparound services and city social services available to them. But you know, it's these systemic and structural issues that plagued our communities for far too long, and I plan on aggressively taking an approach on it.
I heard you speak on the presidential debates, what have you, and you said this just shows how people are looking for a new face and unconventional ideas. I just got finished reading Peter Thiel's 0 to 1. He talked about unique concepts. What are some of these unique concepts or unconventional ideas that you may have that shake things up for Baltimore? Because like you said, people don't want to hear the same rhetoric and the same, obviously something has to change.
Yeah. Well, if you come to Baltimore, say if you're coming to visit Baltimore, you're gonna go to, you know, when you come here, you're gonna go to specific areas, probably around the harbor, you know, places that have been built up for quite some time. But unfortunately, that same creativity to development hasn't happened in our communities in East and West Baltimore, like where the unrest took place. So as the next mayor of Baltimore, what I'm going to do is develop these bold districts or bold zones to ensure that these tax incentives, that these public subsidies are directly targeted to the areas in which need spur of development. And unfortunately, we have not seen that in Baltimore. And you know, it's not a West Baltimore thing. That's the one thing out of the unrest. Many people are talking about, oh, West Baltimore. But urban blight is as American as apple pie. Whether it's in West Baltimore, North Philly, East New York, or the South Side of Chicago, it's all the same. And I think right now we have a very unique opportunity in our country, specifically as young folks, to come together and say enough is enough. And you know, whether you're in West Baltimore or East New York, it's all the same, and we're going to fight for, you know, social change and social equalities that we've deserved for far too long. these are decade-old issues that, you know, we're plaguing out. And, you know, when you talk about the violence, when you talk about the blight, when you talk about all the issues in our communities, they're nothing more than symptoms from failed policies and bad decisions for the past couple of decades.
Okay. Now, back to the presidential debates. I know you said this is the most you've ever watched, and I think every Democrat, this is the most we've ever watched the Republican debates. Are you still watching? Is it still entertaining after some of the things that transpired?
No, actually, at this point, it's just becoming one, redundant, completely tapped out, and it's really scary where our country is. I mean, you think of some of the front runners, you think of some of the incendiary things that they've been able to say,
and people are
literally buying into it. I mean, you know, say for instance, the front runner won Massachusetts and I think Mississippi or Alabama. So, like, you know, it's a cross section of very diverse individuals that are coming out and supporting some of these folks. So, you know, it's concerning.
Okay. Now, when you win as mayor in Baltimore, what are some of the expectations that you have for the future president as far as them helping you fix the things that need to happen in Baltimore?
So it's interesting because right now, this marks 50 years of a lot of important things for the Civil Rights Movement. Mm-hmm. You know, the Civil Rights Act, the Housing Act, the Voting Act. But unfortunately, many of the things that were thought to be put in place 50 years ago still hasn't transpired today. Many of our communities look the same way, if not worse, than what they were 50 years ago. So I think we need a president more than ever that's going to really go after and tackle urban blight and provide real opportunities for all citizens throughout this country. And, you know, that's what I'm looking for, to partner with the next president. I think I present a very unique story in a major city like Baltimore. I tell folks all the time, you know, being born and raised in a place like Baltimore, seeing the best, seeing the worst of the city, but then also having the chance to go to college, come back, do really well in corporate America. I can go to any corporate boardroom, look at a problem, help develop a solution, and execute on it. But I also can go to any street corner in the city of Baltimore, whether East or West Baltimore, and do the same exact thing. And in our urban areas, we need that type of transformative leadership now more than ever. And that's what I think I bring to the table.
Okay. Now, like you said, your story is definitely captivating. And one amazing and great thing about your story is your family dynamic. I heard you say at one point your wife was considered the wife of Nick Mosby. Now you're kind of
the husband of the state's attorney.
Yeah. So maybe speak on, you know, the importance of both of you guys making major strides as African Americans in politics and just also highlighting to our individuals the importance of the family dynamic and showing that.
Well, when we talk about our communities, one of the main symbols of the systemic issues in our communities is the breakdown of the family. Mm-hmm. You know, I grew up without a father, my mother grew up without a father, Marilyn grew up without her father. You know, this is a very common story, unfortunately, in many of our communities. So I think symbolically what we represent, living in the heart of West Baltimore, I mean, when we moved back to Baltimore, we didn't decide to move in an affluent area. I was an electrical engineer, Marilyn was about to become an attorney. We could have moved anywhere, but we moved in the heart of West Baltimore. It would kind of be like North Philly or East New York, and literally right around the corner from where the unrest took place. I mean, my house was abandoned for 20 years before we bought it from the city of Baltimore. But I say that because we represent a symbol of what the family structure should be.
Hip-hop's is 1987.com. 1987.com. 1987.com.